Well, welcome back to another build of the RatRig. Yeah, from a very hot and humid UAE. I'm looking forward to tonight's build again. Going to be quite a lot happening. I've done quite a bit of preparation work this week, and I think we're going to see quite a few things happen tonight, and quite a few parts go onto the actual frame and onto the printer. So, really looking forward to it. If you're watching this live, welcome. You're welcome to drop comments at any point in time. I'll try and get through all your questions. And if you're watching this post the stream, well, let me know. And it's good to see some people watching that afterwards, and you can still add some comments, and I'll try and get to those comments wherever I can. So you'll see I've got a cameras a little bit higher tonight because we're going to be standing a lot and we're going to be working a lot on the printer. And because of that, I'll have to be moving the cameras around a little bit. So a little bit of patience, because we're now getting to little nitty-gritties, little components, which make it, going to say, harder to get all the camera angles right. But let's get going. I want to get started with quite a few things. I've actually, as I said, done in the week, I've done quite a bit of prep work, and I'll say it up front, some of the items where I see there's a duplicate where we have to do something on the left and on the right, some of the stuff I've done this in the week just so that I could prep and make sure that we don't have any can I say nasties that arise, and anything that I figured out that doesn't look like it was covered in the documentation, or where I find that I found a better method of doing it, I'll elaborate that on the opposite side of the component that I'm busy with. With that, let's get going. Just as an overview, let's go to the document, and we can have a look at what we did. So last week we got to actually assembling the CoreXY mobile motor assemblies, and when we did do that, we started putting these plates in place, and we found that the plate at the bottom, this little green one, didn't actually fit the bolts very well, and I decided, well, let's call it an evening there and I'll go and investigate those. Unfortunately, yes, those little green plates don't fit the bolts that very well, and actually in the documentation I read up, one or two people just said, you know what, these plates are there but they add no value, and I agree, I can't see the value in it, and to the point where some people actually even said they just left it out. I didn't want to leave it out. I went to our very well developed fusion diagram, and I had a look for the part inside here, and I could eventually find it inside underneath at the back of one of these motors thing over there. I downloaded the part into fusion 360 and I modified it slightly to make the holes bigger, and I've put them in. So on the one side I've put them in already, and on the other side we will I've actually put them in on both sides already, so it's already in, and we're pretty much where we were, where we start, based on where we stopped last week Sunday, and we'll start working on that. Now you'll see the side cameras already up here, because we're going to be working up the top here, so don't worry about that. Looks funny at the moment on the screen, but for now we're going to get to that soon. But let's just go back to the documentation. So we bolted the bolts at the bottom here, make sure that's nicely up against the frame. As a matter of interest, if I can just come over here and point out that inside this bracket over here, I don't know if you can really see it there, maybe I'll bring the camera just a little bit closer so you can see. So with that bracket coming in over there, please take note that if you use a 4mm or thicker acrylic panel, you're going to have some issues. 4mm is the absolute maximum that would probably fit in there. I don't know what would happen if you have to move this bar this whole section 1 millimeter forward. We will have to see. I'm not going to do it. I knew that prior to building this that I only had 4 millimeters possibility to play with, and so I did only 4 millimeter acrylic panels. I've already been told that the 4 millimeter is an overkill. I only need 3 millimeter, but I did go with the 4 millimeter because I wanted a little bit more insulation if I can. The more heat I can keep inside, the better for me, as I will be printing quite a bit of ABS and ASA, most likely some other compounds as well as I go along. Right, coming back to the documentation, when you finished that section, we sort of touched base and started on this, and that's where I realized that wasn't very happy with the bolts, and I removed the bottom piece and rebuilt it. But now that it's all good, we can continue. I've already installed the left one, and very simple. We put the bracket in, the bolts from the bottom, put the brackets in, right? And we then put the flange bearings and the normal bearings and all the shims and all the spacers in as per the diagram document over here. And then we put, well, basically squeeze it together. Okay. Just going to go back slightly. They basically push these two bolts that you're seeing over here already in on this step. That's why we won't see it later, but I'm going to do it on the new side so that you can just see what's going on. So let's go down. We're going to go from the left. I've done the left. I'll explain the belts again. You're going to have belts at different times. On the left hand side, the bottom belt will run differently. It will run around the back of the unit, whereas the top belt will run inside the unit where the motor lies, right? So this CoreXY motor cage will belt lies on the top on the left hand side. On the right hand side, this is going to be slightly different. And so once we've finished going through the left and we've put the top piece on and we've tightened three of those screws in and we've tightened the bottom screws to pull all of that together, we then get to putting a motor in for months, and we have a timing pulley. All of this I'm going to do on the right hand side again. They do give you a measurement as to how far the measurement must be. So for the left side, which would differ from the right side, this would be a 9.5 millimeter gap. Again, you're going to go at some stage, and you're actually going to with your eye, when the belts are tight and everything's pulled tightly, you're going to actually move that pulley up and down into the right position so that you can make sure it's not rubbing against the sides of the flange bearings. Nothing much there we'll cover for now. We will go into the next part. Four bolts holding the motor in. Once you've tightened those in, you can then see through the sides, and then they tell you to adjust the grub screw, loosen the grub screw, adjust the pulley to make sure that it's sitting nice and level. Now, I don't agree with this stage at this point because the belts are so floppy and all over the show. You cannot tighten that 100%. Without having to hold multiple belts and stuff. And I don't see the purpose of doing it right now. When we've got the whole assembly in and we start pulling it together, before we cut the belts, we will actually, we'll line that up and make sure that it's nice and straight. So I'm just going to do that a little bit later. One thing they did talk about in the early stage was the actual belt. And you get a very long belt. This is a 6 millimeter belt that I'm holding in my hands. And they let you know that you should cut the belt in half. Now, I just want to quickly touch base on that. Cutting the belt is pretty simple. Cut it in half. But you really actually want to get the belt as equal as possible. So what I've always done in the past is I take the belt, and let me go to maybe the side camera just for a moment so I can really, really get up close. Let's go with this one. So what I do is I take my two sides that are got the teeth on it, right? And I turn them face to face, and I basically leave those two belts almost equal, okay? And then I will take a pair of scissors. Let me grab scissors here. And I will cut that exactly together, right? Now that they cut together, I'm gonna hold this belt all the way, and I'm gonna run all along the belt, right? Let the teeth stay together the whole time. That way, the teeth keep the belt length equal, and there's no differentiation between each of the belts running past your fingers. It has to stay in place, and when you get to the end, you're gonna have the loop. Just squeeze the loop until it just get to the right to the end, and then at some point, cut the loop off when it's nice and tight. That way, you're going to have two perfectly equal belts. Now, that's how I do it. There might be a million ways to do it, but I find that's about the best way. I've already done it with the bigger belt, right? I just thought I'd show you on the small belt. Okay. Let's come back to the document where now I'm going to move over to the right hand side. I have obviously done the step where I put in those bolts earlier. This is where we got last week. It's already in here, you inside the side. And it's tied to the bottom and to the four M6 bolts. I think it was M6. Yes, M6 bolts. Right. Then we're going to take some extra bolts. So now I'm going to grab a couple of tools as we go along, because I just know I'm going to use them. And maybe move my chair out of the way so that I don't fall over it the whole time. Yeah, I think that's all I need for now. Let's see what else. Okay, I'm going to need those two parts. Okay. Oh, and I'm going to grab two nuts as well, two M5 nuts. And the reason why I'm going to grab these nuts is you'll see in a little while. While it does sit pretty tight, I'm not going to take a chance that once I put everything in, that it falls out and everything goes all over the show, but to find those shims and those bearings, and that won't be the easiest. So why are my rubber bands rolled up like this? Well, I've got a cat, and that was the best thing ever. He totally enjoyed grabbing those belts and pulling them all over, and if he does arrive tonight, I will definitely have to get rid of him, because he makes my life absolute misery trying to keep the belts out of the way. And well, I see the other cats walking around the bottom here, so while the other cat's around here, maybe he won't even be showing up for a little while. What I have noticed is that the two bottom holes, I want to say these two bolts at the back of here, I recommend you actually just loosen them slightly, giving this green plate a little bit of a space to move, because by having that little place to move, you can actually get these two bolts in properly, because it seems like every time I tightened them, they went off slightly, and the alignment of the holes wasn't great. So let me just quickly loosen these two, and it's going to help if I have the right Allen key. Let's try this one, maybe. Should be better. Oh, that's much better. Hopefully this week I've sorted out the music a little bit, you know. Lesson learnt. make sure your music is equalized, that all the songs are the same level, and that you don't have this blaring one song and then the next song soft. So hopefully that's over there. I don't know if for those that are online, you could maybe just drop a message if the music's too loud, or we can then take it from there. Right, have I loosened this thing enough? Maybe not yet. Let's do a little bit more. Right. Yeah, that plastic insert is now loose. Still don't understand what the purpose of it was. But that's the way it is. Now you can see how nicely that bolt just slides through. And this one as well. I say, very difficult to get all the little holes from all the different angles sometimes. It's like you're constantly running after. Now, I'm not going to tighten those two other bolts for now. I'm just going to leave it there. But you see what happens if you let go. And that's part of the challenge I don't like. Don't quite understand why they did it that way. But it is what it is. So we will have to deal with it. This piece is going to go in here at some stage, and while I'm holding those two bolts in there, we're now going to move on to the next stage where we're actually going to start adding all the bearings. Okay, so this time we've got a massive bearing stack at the back which we need to do. So before we do that one, I'm just going to drop a little nut on the top of the one not in the corner. Just make my life a little bit easier. Although then it could actually just be taken out, but in any case, there it is, done. And I'm going to open up this picture a little bit bigger so that you can just see that. And maybe what I'm going to do, see if I can bring this camera just a little bit closer. Now I've got to try and balance this camera, you know. This frame is not the easiest frame to work with. So let's see if that is going to give you a better view. Yeah, it'll sort of, I'll just move back slightly. It's about the best I can do for now. Maybe I can lift that up, flap that down. There you go. All right, come back to this view so you can sort of see what I'm doing. If I move my hand, big hands out of the way. Right, here you can see that bolt. Let's grab all these bearings. Let me tell you, these holders been really helpful. Okay, there were different screws and different connectors that I've bought over the time, but having the ability to put them in and just sort them out here and there really makes a big difference. So, first, we use a washer. Or a shim, at least. You want to call it that. And then we're going to do a flange bearing. Flange bearing. Straight bearing, or normal bearing, not a straight bearing. These guys are probably having a fit while I'm calling all these things, but another flange bearing, whatever makes sense to you. Another shim. Then flange bearing with the flange pointing downwards this time. And then just the normal bearing. And then the flange bearing again, this time with the flange up. And another shim. And that's the stack, right? That you need to put it there. Now, if I let go of the bolt in the bottom, we shall start again. and hence why I want to actually get ready for it. So you see, you've got to move over to the next bolt. So I'm just going to take a nut for now. I'd just like to put a nut on top of that. Now it can fall as much as it likes, like it did, and it would have disappeared. Let's go to this document and this image, and then we can have a look at the other bolt for now. Right, again, take my retaining nut off for now. I'm going to put on a shim, and I'm going to put on a flange bearing with the flange at the bottom, and a normal bearing, and a flange bearing with the flange piece at the top, and a shim. If I can pick up the shim. Goodness. Okay. The shim is on. And again, they're going to expect me to hold too many things. So before I move on to the next slide, which is this one, I'm again going to just put a nut temporarily on top of that one. Okay. And there she falls through. Okay. Let's see. Thanks to my dad there for letting me know the music and the mic is fine. Really enjoy. Mr. Fig is back online. It's good to see that the things are working tonight. Look, you've got to learn. Every stream is going to be different. And until you get this done, and I think you can do 100 of these streams, you're going to find new ways and better ways of doing it every single time. So yeah, we keep learning. I must say, I've had quite a few views on the short videos, which has been quite good. Quite a few views on the past episodes. I only really discovered hashtagging properly today, so hopefully further videos will get some more attention. Right, so next part is this little bracket, or this little printed part, which they're then going to tell me to put over here with that piece at the back, obviously, because that's where the belt is going to go between. And it's going to look like that. Nothing fancy, just put the piece of plastic down. Now comes the difficult part, the belts. So opposite of the left hand one, on the right hand one, the belt needs to be at the bottom and needs to go through the piece on the bottom, which is not that difficult to do. But what I decided to do, which helped me a lot in the week, was I got a big fat Allen key, right? And I decided to keep it very handy. So I'm going to take the bottom belt from the other side, and I'm going to lift my camera quickly, just thread it through there. And I'm now going to make sure, still with the teeth facing the frame, that the belt goes down the bottom, down the back of all of that, right? And just make sure it goes all the way down. It's a little bit finicky, but you do get it eventually. And then I'm going to take this nice big Allen key and I'm going to drop it into this hole. Right. This week it's going to fall through, so let's do something different. Let's try and just do it with a screwdriver for now. Right, so like that. I'm going to bring the belt around that unit and through the back of these bearing stacks. Okay, so now I think what I'll do is I'll just try and show you a little bit closer what it looks like. Right. Belt goes down the back,
goes around, around the bearing, goes around the screwdriver in this case, and then back out, and then down the other way. Okay. And we can get this belt in the right place as well. All right, so now the top belt is going to do very much easier this time. It's just going to go around the top flange and bearing stack, and that's it. There's nothing more to it. So with that in place, I'm going to lift this out just slightly that you can see what it looks like. There you go. And we now have basically that step complete. And we've got the top belt in place. And we're now going to come in with all of this. So we need to remove those two screws that I had originally, right? And those two button nuts and put them in. Now I'm going to put those nuts in up front. I want to make sure that it's easy to get them in, so it's easier just to push them in up front now. Let me just do that. Because sometimes it's really hard to get these in, and if you can't get them in, then you're actually going to use a bolt to pull them in if you couldn't get them in. So in this case, I'm battling just that little bit to get it in. So I'm just going to take another bolt. Push it through and actually get the nut on the end. Right, just tighten a little bit. Align it with the holes and to just pull through like that. And it'll just pop straight in. Very easy. Don't suffer trying to push it in with your fingers. It's not worth the battle. And it is such a little bit of force that you need to pull with that it's easy just to do it with any bolt. Again, got it there, line it up, and pull. And it's in. Right. And we now need also some countersunk screws that we're going to use at the top here. We're going to need three of these countersunk guys. We can get those ready. And what else? That's it for now. They say push that all together. Drop that down there. You need to put in the 30-30 lock nuts. Now, they say put the lock nuts roughly in the right places. I did mine slightly different again. It just was easier for me to drop the nut in. I'm going to need two at the back and one on the side. Again, this thing is going to stand like this. So I need to put in for those two, and I need to put in for that one over there. So what I'm going to do is just drop two of these nuts into this channel and one nut into this channel, ready to slide. And I'll get myself a bit of a smaller Allen key so that I can actually slide them when I go get there. So those are the two nuts that they actually talk about, those three slide nuts at the back there. Then drop it and tighten it. Now I'm only going to tighten those ones a little bit. I like to tighten those ones very little, and then I first like to tighten these two so that these stacks stand straight up, and then once they're nice and straight, then I can push that towards that corner and tighten that. These are just tightened very loose. I don't tighten them that much. I just want to get a bit of the play out of the stack before I pull it into the corner and tighten those, and then I come back to tighten those two bolts going right through. But let's do that quickly. So here we go. Oh, remember now I've got to do the hold the nuts in place while I drop this plastic in. So I've got my fingers underneath just waiting for the nuts, the bolt to drop out. I'm going to, this one's a little bit easier than the other side, because the other side you had to lower this thing and still get the belt in between and everything. So let's take the Allen key for that one, which I believe was this, and I'm going to take the first one and just turn it slightly. I can see it coming up, and then take the second one. I'm doing this one on the other side. Let's get that right. There's those ones in place. Before I get any further on that, I'm going to now put in these three other bolts, because I want to make sure that it's all straightened up. Now I can feel this belt sitting a little bit skewer here, but that should be fine, because I'm going to pull them tight this way. Just pull two of them either side. Give this one a bit of tension. There we go. Also nice and loose. And move this nut, and just while watching it from the top, I can see that that nut is there. Now this Allen key of mine is nice and magnetized, unfortunately, so it's gripping onto that nut, so I have to do it in one move. All right. Let's likely turn that one in, then take this side, and I'm going to just move this camera back a bit, slide this guy down in till it gets to the furthest hole. Drop that in. Remember, you want to spin it so that it actually does its turn. It must spin inside the channel. So that it twists and locks, so that you can lock. And then we'll do the last one quickly. Now I'm a little bit tall, so it's easy for me to get here, but I see a lot of guys build their machines on the floor. It's just simply because I think the height is a bit of a challenge. I think I've missed this one. Didn't push it in properly. Oh no, I did get it. Okay. Right. Pushing this bracket into the corner. Just got that tight like that. Remember, these are plastic. You printed them. You don't need to tighten them four white knuckles like I did on the steel. On the aluminium extrusions, probably break it if you do. And so just a little bit tight. Don't overdo it. Nothing worse than having to crack a piece and then having to just wait to print a new piece, or have a new piece arrive if you don't have a printer to print a new one. Yeah, so those three on the outside are done. Now I can go back and I can actually have a look at these bottom ones. And I can now tighten the bottom ones as well. So these two bolts over here. Night, I can hear the music that you're hearing as well. It helps a little bit, just to know what you're listening to as well, so things have improved. I don't know if that's so much of a doctor. I was hoping more for engineers, sir. Okay. Again, don't need to tighten these things too much. I've got those nuts that can hold them in place without tightening them too much. So there we've got that section done. We've tightened the top screws. We've tightened the bottom screws. And next is we're going to put a motor in there. The last motor that needs to go into the thing, into the printer. So by the way, these motors are from LDO. I should hashtag them. They're superb motors. I really like the LDO motors. Everybody in the industry uses LDO motors. In my other printers, I've got LDOs, and in the other printer, I've got step-on line. Again, both very good motors, but most people in the industry are using LDO because they're very active in the 3D printing world. Okay, we need to put one of these on top of one of these, right? So we're going to put the G2 timing pulley. And over here, you'll see there's a flat section on the, let me just see if I can get that focus slightly. You can see there's a flat section there. I hope you can see it well enough. You might be able to see it better on this camera. Doesn't want to work with me, but in any case, there's a flat section over there. You want one of the two grub screws that are in this to always be aligned with that flat section on the shaft. And now we need a smaller Allen key. This one here, maybe. Yes. Okay. So now I'm just tightening it slightly. Ever so slightly, just to make sure that it's like just going to push against that flat area, because that's what I... Oh, wait a minute. Yes. I think I'm going the wrong way around here. Luckily, I thought about that. Next step was actually showing the right way around. Nearly made that mistake, but that's okay. You can fix that, luckily. So it's got to go that way around, right? And again, still the same principle. One of the sides needs to be attached, and you can just move it around until you feel it's actually pushing against the flat edge. Let me just try to get that against that flat edge. There we go, against the flat edge. Now, this is where this diagram is a little bit, for me, a little bit weird, because they say from the top of that, and I'll show it to you now, we need to install the shaft, and it needs to be 3 millimeters, the gap, right? Okay, so, I mean, as I said previously, right, 3 millimeter gap, and on the other side I did the gap the same, and I'm not too worried whether I got it 100% right, because I'm going to, in a couple later on at the time, actually align the pulley in the right way. So I just want to show you roughly what I did to get it in the place, right place. You can do it with a ruler. I'm going to do it with a vernier, and I'm going to set my vernier just to 3 millimeters, which is pretty easy to do, yeah, or should be pretty easy, right? And then I'm just going to tighten that screw at the top, and so the gap over there is 3 millimeters, and they're talking from the top of the motor in the picture, right? So let's go back to the picture that they showed us, just so that you can see that. I'll even go in a little bit. So they're talking about the gap from there to there being 3 millimeters. Once it's on the shaft, obviously. So I'm going to take that, and as you can see, very difficult to get my vernier in there because it's pushing against the side here, and I can't get it right. So, plan B. Plan B. I need to get myself just a ruler somewhere quickly. Grab a steel ruler. And I'm going to measure it with the ruler instead. Probably not as accurate as the vernier, but it will do the job. Okay. Just loosen that ever so slightly. Right. This is probably the easiest way and how most people will do it at the end of the day. One, two, three. Nice. Because you're going to check it in any case later on. Oh my goodness. It moved. Do that again. Put it back on three. Yes. All right. So that's 3 millimeters. But again, you've got a second charge later. No point in tightening it too tight at this point. No point in tightening the second grub screw because you're going to check the height later on. Okay, let's put the camera back up here so you can see what I'm doing. I must say, these little tripods have been quite a lifesaver. They with little adjustable legs, so I can actually balance it everywhere on the printer itself, which works quite well. Okay, let's go back to that there, or ultimately we need to go back to this document and say, right, once we've put that, they actually tell you, let's do this, let's close here. They actually align the grub screws and then they tell you to tighten it. So now I'm not going to do that 100%. Right. We need M335s. Let's grab some M335s. Yeah, that's not a bad idea. I can probably use a 3mm drill, put it in there. That's probably the easiest way of doing it. Maybe I should have just done it that way, it would have been quicker. But I've now measured it and I'm going to check it in any case because I want to make sure that the belt sits perfectly in between. Oh goodness. You know what? You know what I've done? I've pulled this belt all the way to the back. Almost. So when you pull the belt like this, be very careful. Luckily I didn't push it all the way. So the belt is still in that hole because the motor and the pulley, this pulley needs to go up and between the belt. Otherwise, what's the point of it, eh? Right. So you can probably see from that side, there's a belt inside there. Four screws. Let's go with this one. It's going to and see if we can grip the motor. Okay, got the motor. Now, don't tighten it all the way. Just do a little bit. You just want to get all the screws in before you start tightening. Okay. Helps to have some power screwdrivers, goes a lot faster. And let's go with this one. What have I got this on? Let's put it on the least, just in case I do go tight. Yeah, that is I'm not going to do too tight with this machine. I'm just going to get it roughly tight, and then I'm going to do it with the hand so that I could gauge how tight it is. Again, this is plastic housing, so you don't want to overdo it. Obviously, you don't want it to come loose because it is your motors, ultimately. But you can gauge how tight you think. Can't torque everything, unfortunately, I don't think. Okay. All right. So that pulleys around there. Have a look at the pulleys. Just put these two in the right place roughly. Push them against the frame. And then pull that. Yep, all good. Great. So we've got those four screws in. And again, they're going to tell you to check the pulley and adjust the height, which I'm going to do at a later stage. And that's the end of the CoreXY motor mounts. We next move on to X-axis assembly. Ooh, getting interesting. So we need to do some work on the table. So let me just move some of the containers out of the way, because it's now going to be table work. Okay, these are still the shims. I keep all the little plastics until I've finished using every little part, just in case. Don't want to lose it. Those in there. That in there. Tidy up. Don't need these to this moment. And we're good to go. That way. And I'm going to bring the camera down again, because we're now going to be looking at my hands on the table, putting more things together. Now, I don't have an overhead camera. Some guys use an overhead camera, but then they're able to zoom. I'm not going to be able to zoom, so I'll just have to do with what I have. We have the core, the X-axis assembly that we're going to now work on. Again, in the previous video, in video three, we got linear rails ready. And I think I'm just going to say it. I'm not going to do I've prepared the linear rail up front. Watch video three. I went in depth how to grease it, how to get your grease and your oils and everything in place. I spoke a little bit about the different lubes that I use, and you can just take it from there. Nothing different really about the rail, except in this rail we're not going to be using the bigger M5s. I think we used in the previous ones. We're now using M3s, slightly shorter, because it's going into a slightly smaller extrusion bar. Aluminium extrusion. Okay, so we got a couple of pieces, prints, bolts, shims, things that we need already, and spacers. 6mm spacers. Got the precision shims. We have got some small bearings, and then we've got some flange bearings and some very long bolts. Okay, so let's move on. I'm going to start with the left hand side here tonight, and I'm going to try and run through it this way. No, let's do it this way so that you can sort of see what's happening. I'm going to put my camera up slightly so that I can work in front of me. Okay. You're going to have to orientate whatever way it makes sense to you. Look at the picture. I'm going to orientate it what it looks like in front of me so that I don't get confused. And the first thing we're going to do is take one of the M555 bolts, right, and push it through. And I only have two left. You'll guess why, because I did the other half already. Okay, so click that bolt, push it through. And here comes the interesting part. You have to build it while pushing it through. So as you're going through, you're going to have to put all those things on and then slowly go through. So let's start. We're going to do a shim. Probably holding it at a little bit of an angle like this would help make your life a little bit easier. I'm going to turn the camera just slightly this way that you can see me better. I don't have to break my wrists off to getting the angles right. So, shim. Flange bearing with the flange to the outside. Normal bearing. And a flange bearing. Right, here we're going to have a shim. Right, one from the shim. Then we're going to have 2 6mm spacers. Starts becoming hard. You've got to get your position, your fingers a little bit more and more accurate as you start pushing this bolt through. Because now it starts getting a bit tricky. So I'm going to drop that one a little bit. Let's see if I shake it, if I can get it to come into the right place. There we go. Come on. Drop out rather. Thank you. Let's try and do that again. And there we go. And then the worst one is probably getting the last one in, which is the shim right in that corner over there. So I'm going to, sorry if you can't see what I'm doing, but better I see than what you see at this point in time. Through and bolt goes all the way through. Okay, bolt goes all the way through. Now with the bolt through, you're now going to do a couple other things. Again, I'm just going to put a little nut on the end here just to make sure we don't have any nasty surprises. And that's what it will look like when it's done. Right, they then tell you to flip it over. Okay. And then you're now going to do the opposite side. So again, bolt from that side. And we're going to do the shim first. It's really getting hard to pick up these shims now because there's less and less of them. So get that one in there. Oh goodness, come on. Don't make it too difficult. No, I don't want that. Let's back it like that a little bit. And then we are going to go with 2 6mm spacers. I don't know how much there is a delay in the stream tonight, so if I make a mistake, don't wait until 5 minutes and then let me know after 5 minutes, because then I might be 10 minutes ahead of you already. Alright, we're going to have a shim after the two spaces. Right. Good. Next, we're going to have the flange bearing again. the outside. Normal bearing. Move that up like that. And then a flange bearing. There goes my last flange bearing. Meaning I've done all the belt flanges for now. That's great. Okay. And then the tricky one. One more shim. Pick up the shim. Yeah, I'm going to get this shim through. Not the easiest positioning to hold that shim. Because the flange is so wide, you sort of got to like drop it in and then squeeze it slowly between the two and keep pushing the bolt with the hope that you actually catch it. Here we go. Nice. And for now I'm just going to chuck another nut on the end just so not lose anything. Okay. So we've completed it, right? Looks like that. And now we're going to go on to this. Let me just drop my volume a little bit on my side. I don't know if you can hear me nice and clearly. If I need to bring the volume down a little bit on the music, just let me know. Seems to be okay. Could possibly be a bit lower, but I'm not sure. Okay. Now, the next one they say is the right axis. Well, how about that? You don't have to watch me again. I've done the right axis already earlier in the week. Nice. We now move on to the rail. Right, and we now need to insert, we need to wipe down the rail, we need to put some grease in the block like I've shown in video 3, and then we wipe down the rail a little bit again with some oil, and then we start putting in all those screws. Right, I'll get through to it now, but in the meantime we need to take a M5 bolt. Let me just see where my M5s are. What did I do with the M5s? M5 by 10. Where are the M5 by 10s? Those are definitely the M6s, and M5 by 10. What's this? Flange bearings done. Throw the packet away. No more of those left. We're gonna use these three and throw that one away. Okay. So, in the same way that I've done the right-hand side one earlier on, I'm now going to do the left-hand side one quickly. Push that through there, and then we need to get a M5 flat T-nuts. Where did I put those? Oh, I put them over here. Right. So these extrusion T-nuts are slightly different. They don't twist into the channel. They just pretty much slide into the channel, right? And because we're using a smaller channel, they're quite a bit smaller than the others. So let's have a look. We are going to take let's do the bottom one first, just make life a little bit easier from a handling perspective. And Easy. Easier said than done, eh? Not wanting to work with me tonight. And my hands are just a bit silly tonight. Alright, there we go. That's the first one. Second one in. Right, both those are in. Okay, and we're going to tighten them up because we're going to tighten them in again inside the plate. Next step is we're actually going to put the ends onto the extrusion. Obviously, I can do some of this. I didn't want to do this week, so it'll happen right now. Let me put that inside there for now, just to keep it identified until we need it. Ah, no, wrong way. Let's check that one in there and just put these two back in there. Bit of a waste of time, sorry guys, but I'm fanatical about knowing what's what. Okay, next. We're now going to insert this tubing. Alright. So, I'm going to try and put it over here where you can see it. These nuts need to go into there. Okay. So, I'm going to push those two nuts in with my fingers a little bit and see if I can get them to slide down the rail. First one in line. Ooh, that doesn't check in the week. Does the rail actually fit inside the extrusions that I have? Oh, it's very tight. Let's see how I'm going to get that right. There we go. I'll turn that one that way. Because it now needs to go inside there. Let's see if I loosen that one just slightly more. There we go. All the way in. Okay, and then the same on the other side. So I hope you can see sort of what I'm trying to do, but not the easiest to hold everything. Again, get this T-nut to line up with the rail. Get that one in there. And there we go. Alright. One's in there. Should I maybe show you what we've got? Okay. And both these are pointing in the right direction still. Should have just made sure about that before I put it in. Alright, so they're saying you're going to push those in like that. And once they're pushed in, we're then going to come to here, and we're going to tighten the M5 screws on the bottom of those two rails. Now, to me, this thing could have a bit of play, although it doesn't feel like it. So for now, while I am going to sort of tighten them, I'm not going to tighten them very tight at this point. I'm going to tighten them once I've got them on the actual rail, so that if I need a bit of movement, I've still got a bit of play. It's not going to come loose. It's pushed in pretty tight. So I important is that when it's all the way together, that you've pushed them on as far as you possibly can. Let's read what this guy has said. Comments here. Let's see. Maybe there's some interesting comments here. Might require some jam and carving to get the joiners in. Don't damage the. Okay, make sure you get the joiners first, then remove the joiners. That's all. Oh, okay. But it's really tricky to get the thread inserts into nuts. Well, I didn't suffer that much, but okay, this guy did have a bit of problems. Do not allow. Okay, well, I got it in. I didn't have too much hassles over there. I'll post a comment maybe later on saying it was easy. Irritate them.
Okay.
First thing, as I say, tighten. Now the rails. The actual rail that I have prepared up front. So let's move this slightly back. And let's open this rail over here. See, I just closed it off because I didn't want the oil everywhere. And you will notice that all the bolts are in. How about that? You don't have to watch me put bolts in like in episode 4 or part 3. This is for part 3 when we had to sit and watch me put all those bolts in. I've done it all up front. So, what they want us to do, put those bolts in and then drop that into the pole. See, there's lots of comments here. Probably worth reading these comments from time to time. Yeah, okay, nothing major there. Then we're going to tighten this. Now they say fasten the Mark M3 screws starting from the left. There's been debate whether we should have done this from the middle and outwards. I tend to believe that middle out is the way to do it, but I will honor the instructions that they give us, and I shall do it that way. So let's turn this thing the other way around. Okay. Take this. You understand why I put nuts on these on the ends here? Because you keep turning it upside down, you keep losing these bolts. Very difficult. Right. Let's get these all straight. You see, I'm not rushing this. Yes, I could probably rush to get the stream done as quickly as possible, but it's about doing it and enjoying it as well. You need to enjoy your build. You're not enjoying the build, then why are you building? So that's something I want to do, is I want to enjoy it. I'm having a look here. There's much play on this side. No, not much play there. Not much play there. Okay. There's no brackets that come for this. I assume they want us to just have a tighten from that side. Okay. So last time we used this tighten, we shall do it again. Let's go ahead and just run all of these quickly. Starting from the left, they said. Let's honor it. There's an L on this side, so it will start on that side. How about that? I'm just going to try and make sure it's roughly in the middle. Yeah. Now, I'm going to hold it on this side. Remember, I'm just letting the motor run. I'm not going to let the motor grind it too much. because these bolts are, these M3s are really soft. And you really don't want to strip them if you can avoid it. I've got hundreds of spares of these because my first linear rail exercise, I over-tightened them on my other printer, and I ruined so many of them. I just couldn't understand why you wouldn't want to tighten them. So I'm going to take this Allen key and just double check. And I'm not going to use the full length of the Allen key. Yeah, that's all pretty tight. And if I feel what it feels like when using the leverage of the Allen key, yeah, that's good. Yeah, I'm not going to do any more on that.
Cool.
Let's take a piece of paper here. It's got lots of excess on top here. Nice and smooth. I still got the rubber bobs in. Right, so let's take the little rubber plugs in. I just moved them in one screw from where the bolts were just to keep them in place. Works very well. Now, no more runaway block. And nice and smooth. Put a bit of pressure on it, runs so nice. Absolutely, I can listen to that all day. Okay, let's move on. Next thing is they're going to ask us to put the end stop block on the top. Now, maybe I'll just switch to the camera, look up at the camera a little bit. There's two ways of doing end stops. You can do, well, there's a couple of ways of doing end stops, which probably the most common ways is either you use micro switches for end stop, or you do what they call sensorless homing. I plan to do sensorless homing, meaning the motor runs along the rail, and when it gets to the side, it actually bumps against the edge, and there's a feedback in terms of torque, current increase on the motor. And that tells the board to stop because it's going to reach the end. It is super fast. It is very accurate. So it's one set of wires less, and it's also easier to keep the end stop in the right place, and you have the setting consistent, because this isn't going to change. Although the end block, stop block doesn't move much, but then you've also got the extra wires running around. So I'm just going to do the sensorless blocking. So everywhere where we see end stops, I'm going to put the end stop holders in, because I actually want to see up to where the motor is going to run, where it should. Maybe I must stop it before it actually hits the green, maybe just hit the black piece. This black piece that they're showing over here, right? But I'm not actually going to put the micro switches in on many other places. Okay. So did I take that block out anyway? Did I prepare it? It doesn't look like I did. Doesn't look like I put it anyway. So you can just excuse me for a moment while I go and look what I did with that piece. Ah, got it. And you say we're going to use, in this case, a M5x18 screw. I don't think I got that out. Let me just have a look. I don't think anything over here is a M5x18. Let me just have a look at the back here. M5x12, 16. Oh my goodness. 16 M5 by 18.
Here we go.
So far must be, so I'm very impressed with the screws and the packing. I've had one mishap, one little mishap, and that was a M3 18 screw. We'll get to it a little bit later. One of the M3 screws was supposed to be a 18 and was something like and in the pack was a 15 instead of 18. That's the only thing. Oh goodness, there's one thing I have forgotten to do. Let me go back. You see. Let's go back to, unfortunately, all the way back. Oh my goodness, that's really not great. Right. In this, oh yeah. They tell you, you need to put a T-nut into that extrusion over there, into the pipe, before you push it in. Oh goodness, okay, well, gotta fix it. Go back slightly, luckily not too much work. Loosen that one again. Practice makes perfect. Right. Push that off. Okay, like that. And that's where these last two came from. I forgot to put in. Because that's going to go onto that bolt, correct? That's it, Raymond. Okay. Well, let's slide that in. Bring it this way and see. You need to slide this nut, this block inside here, just at the end there. It can't go too far because the other nuts and everything are going to block it in any case. And I think that's why they ask you to put it in, so that you can slide it when you need to. All right, let's just loosen these things again and make sure I get myself maximum opportunity to get them in. And push that one up. That one slightly at an angle. Why won't you go in? Maybe I will feel like those other guys that couldn't get it in. Hey Terry, sorry I didn't see your message. Don't know how long it's been there. How did it go with the printing of the bones? Busy printing a Terry's busy printing a skeleton for his daughter's medical curiosity and love for the skeleton and the body. So okay, I'm not getting this thing in this time, and definitely harder the second time around. So, laughing at those guys earlier, probably not the best, because now I'm battling. Okay, definitely need to make these things come out a whole lot more. That's where the problem comes in. Okay, do it like that. Yeah, that's my problem. Push that in there. Do that then a slight nudge at the bottom. Nudge, come on. Push this in slightly like that. There we go. Testing myself again. Making that mistake was not nice. Wasting time. It's okay. We'll catch up. Arms. Tighten it slightly. Got it. Ribcage. Goodness. That must be quite interesting to see how that print. Probably got a lot of supports on it. If you think about the ribcage, probably need a lot of supports to get that done in between all the ribs. I'm just trying to see in what orientation would you print that. Ribs pointing up? Most likely. If you've been in the printing game long enough, you immediately try and think, okay, what's the best way to print that, you know, without having supports. Less support means less post-processing. Okay. Turn this over again and put this nut that I forgot in. Then just wipe that off. Okay. The nut is that side, I just double checked. Just to make sure I wasn't missing it. And to make sure I give this thing maximum right there. Because if you angle it, I just find if you angle it and you actually push it up against the nut, I don't know if I can really show you that. But you're sort of like coming from an angle, you can sort of get the nut in place with it being straight. It's just, you just do it while looking at it straight as well. Come from the bottom, push up like that, and it slides into the channel like that. Oh, all the way. Nice. Very nice. Supports account for the majority. I can imagine ribs. It's not much meat or bones, anything between them. So you've got to just... Don't you wish you had an IDEX printer now with two heads where you could print with dissolvable filament and then just afterwards chuck it into a bath and see the ribs appear. That would be cool. Okay. Right, we're back. Now that I've got that out of the way, let's get back to where we were. And that was to put that on the fastening. In stop. Okay, I'm just trying to see the end stop is on that one over there. If I swing this around and look at my picture, no, it's this way. Okay, don't want to put things in the wrong place. Okay, so we're going to put the end stop onto this block now. Okay. And then that magic little nut at the bottom should catch this. And it does. It does. Now, how do you set the M stop? Well, we don't. We just sort of give it a bit of a twist and we leave it like that.
The correct position for the end stop block will be set in the building, the EVA 3 assembly at a later point. Take care not to cover, not to tighten the M5 18 screws as you can damage. Yeah, well, we don't want to over tighten. So that's there. It is in place now. We can move on. On the other side, they're just going to put a M512. What is this? M5? The M510. Let's see if I've got an M512 lying around. No. That's finished. That's finished. That's finished. That's finished. That's finished. M512. Let me just see if I've got M512. Yes, I do. You see, everything's there. Can't point fingers anywhere yet. It's really, if you think about it, it's a custom kit, so you order the size that you want and you tell them, I want this part, I want that part. So they put all of this together in little packets and all, it's all got to come together. Otherwise, how many clients are they going to irritate? So their process must be quite well established. Anyway, so spin this around. And this is just going to go in there. It just another support on the actual extrusion that holds the extrusion in place. Again, I'm not going to tighten it that much. I'm just going to keep it slightly loose because I'd like to see that this head is straight before I start tightening things straight with the rest of the printer. Okay. Now we need to put brackets in and these brackets I need to fetch as well. Oh, I thought I prepared all the parts. Looks like I skipped a whole section. Right, those are M5 nylon locking nuts, which is these here, and the M3x8 cap head screws. M312s, M5, M335s, M3, I guess here's the M38s, but the M38s, and then the two joiner plates. Certain parts are steel that they actually manufacture and send with. I think these are the parts that need to be stronger, which they know if you print everything probably won't work that well, so they do send well engineered parts as well, like the rest of the frame. Okay, so we're now going to put this on the end. Having a look at this plate, whether it's this way or this way, okay, doesn't seem to be much of a difference, but it depends on the configuration of the bolts at the bottom. We can put it on, tighten that, and then have it in place. Again, I'm not going to tighten these two until a little bit later. Tighten them 55. Repeat the steps on the right hand side. Okay, and the reason why I'm not going to do this, I'm going to show this in the document, is I want that, and then the whole extrusion to sort of seat itself straight before I tighten it. So my first major tightening will be these four bolts. I want these four bolts tight. Then I'm going to push both linear rails to the back, right, of the printer, and make sure they balance against one of the sides.
either the front, total front of the machine or the total back of the machine. We'll have a look at that now. And then once I finish with that, I'll start tightening these bottom ones and all the other bolts that were in the middle over here, like these ones, this one, and the two bolts on either side. I'll only do that then, because then I know at least the rail is 90 degrees to the frame and well aligned. So let's flip this over and take my these nuts off. I'm going to use them in any case. So this one's going to go like that. Okay, so I'm just going to put on that corner, catch that one quickly before I lift the whole stack and drop the bolt out the bottom. Okay. Off. Right, slide that around, drop it on there, and get that there. Right, now I'm going to give it a bit of a tighten because it's very far. Where's my socket here? I'm going to give it a bit of a turn. And here comes our other furry cat. He's going to now to find this position here. And he's now walking on my keyboard. As you can see, the document moved all over. Welcome, welcome. No, 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 you can't. You need to lie up. And that's not going to stop him. So what's going to have to happen now for me to keep him out of the way is I'm actually going to have to give him something to do, or I'm going to have to chase him away. But you will see he's going to headbutt me until he gets the amount of tension he needs. Yes, aren't you? Okay, that's fine for now. I'm not going to over tighten that. Gives me just that little bit of play on the top of that there. Swing this around. It's got to go this way this time. Okay. Playing with the belts. As long as he doesn't chew holes into the belts, I should be fine. If it was the other cat, I'd be very concerned. Here he comes. He's going to want to find a position on this table because I need to be part of all the action. I've been upstairs for a long time. I've probably been sleeping for ages. Great. Last weekend when everybody saw you, you looked somewhat different. Yeah. You looked totally different last week. Why? Because you had so much more hair. Or at least fur. Put it that way. But it's so hot here, like 40 something degrees outside. It's well worth giving him a bit of a shave and a bit of a break. And hopefully he can live a little bit more comfortably. Probably bruises his ego a little bit, making him look the way he does. But he seems to be happy. Alright. Okay. So now I need to switch to a different camera view. What are you going to eat? You see, always got something. Play with the belts. That's fine. Okay, what I'm going to now do is flip the printer around, or swing it around. It's easy to flip, it's heavy. And we are then going to work on the other side so that you can see more. Let's move this camera cable out of the way. Everything is exciting with him. All right. Not easy to move this frame. If you think I've got long arms. So, here we go. Right. Change of scenery. Change of view. Welcome back to the front of the printer. And we are now going to follow the next step, which was... Where did you take me, Kat? Oh, right. We're going to put this rail on. Obviously, we need to make sure right is on right. And left's on left. And we're going to tighten those bolts at the bottom. And then we're going to... Yeah, go down there. You want to go and fetch that belt that you dropped. Go fetch it down there before you kick all my bolts off the table. We need to do both sides tight on. Okay, and these were with the M3x8s. M3x8s. It's actually for all the large bolts and everything you've got in place, you really put really small bolts into the blocks. It's actually quite scary that it's got to hold all the weight. So we need one more. Great. I'm going to put these over here. And we're going to get one of the Allen keys right. So I'm going to just move this keyboard in case the cat decides to walk on it again. He's now playing down the bottom there, very content. He's got half belt, and we need to make sure that we've got the right Allen key. This is not the right one. This is the correct one. Okay, let's see if we start on one side. We can sort of point up. Right. The belts, I'm going to move them out of the way for a little while. Let's see if we can switch to that view for now. And we're going to bolt into that block on this side and the same on the opposite side. The belts, I'm just going to let hang over like that for a while. That out of the way, and make sure I've got the right side on the right side now, eh? Left, and this is the right stone. That's right, left. Okay, I'm mumbling to myself. I've got to make sure that I'm correct in what I'm doing. Let's do. Oh, a major part going onto the printer. Okay, while you're watching that side, I'm going to walk around and grab one of these bolts onto one of these bolts into here, so that it's sort of balanced. A little bit worried there that it was too long. But it fits. Right. I'm going to put in all four screws on each side before I even start any of the tightening process, just to make sure they're all inside the blocks. that one. Maybe I should be lifting the machine up, then I can see the bit underneath here, but I don't think we're going to do much work upside down, so. Do that one. And you can sort of see, can't totally show you because it's dark screws and dark box, but in any case, trust me, there's four in. Okay. And then I'm going to go to the opposite side and do that one. So Terry, how many hours of exoskeleton printing have you done in total now? And what's the point? Are you building the whole body? And does it push together? Does it clip together, or do you have to wire it together, or? Should dial you in. Right, so I'm now going to put this camera over here. I want to show you something. I'm going to try and show you something. Let's try. Okay. Let's flick it up a little bit more. Okay. So what was my big concern? Why didn't I tighten it? So I'm going to look over this way so you can see me. Maybe I can stand here. Right. So the reason why I didn't want to trying to find a way to see me. The reason why I didn't want to tighten everything is, can you see there's this play, right? And I really want to make sure that when I tighten all these bolts, that it's actually straight, right? And why straight? Because that affects the way it's going to run on this rail. So what I want to ideally do is run it all the way maybe to, yeah, or to that side, and then tighten it. Now that rail is running all the way and hits these aluminium, these blocks, which I don't think is really what I want to see. So what I think I'm going to do is rather take it to the opposite side, and I'll just move you back so that you can see that. Take it to the opposite side where we've got these yellow blocks in, which then give us a much better straight line. Okay. And I'm then going to tighten first, holding that, I'm first going to tighten those on the block on the rail. Make sure that rail, that thing's happy. Now, there might be comments later on about I've done it wrong. I'm happy to hear every single one of those comments from the guys that have built these things before and tell me how I should have done it differently. And if I have to come back and fix it, I will. But to me, I want to make sure these blocks are straight. And I think this is the only way I can think at this point in time which makes sense to do. Over here, you're going to see one of the rods and rails in. I've done that as a test earlier on in the week. So we'll get to that a little bit later if you're wondering. No, you didn't miss that. I just did that earlier in the week. Always try and cross tighten if you can. So again, don't tighten these things so tight that you can't do anything with them, because you'll just strip the block. You don't want to strip the block, because then you have to buy a whole new rail just to find a block that will be perfectly matched to this rail. Is not the easiest. I wouldn't want to take the chance. Right, so with the blocks now tightened, we can come back and say, do we have play? And we still have play, as you can see. And that's why the last piece I haven't tightened yet. But what I can do now is just feel it's already moving very easily, very smooth. Right, now let's start off with one. I'm going to start off with one screw on each side. I'm going to hold like that. Through there. I nearly thought they forgot to put holes in for me to get to. Okay, so I'm going to tighten just one screw first on this side. And one on this side. And I'm tightening the ones on the inside first, because it still gives me a bit of leverage on the outside there. Okay. Come on. What wrench you go in? There we go. Right, now I don't have any more ability to move it, so it's now, it's still got a little bit of movement, that's fine, get better, so still moving freely, happy that that's as smooth as what it needs to be for now. Okay, so that's it. I need to work it all out, but I'm done. I'm trying to think, Terry, what would be the, you almost need to sort of like, if you want it to be able to move, you need to do some form of rubber band stuff, but can you really hook rubber bands on there anyway? I don't think so. Just trying to think of the pictures I've seen, what you've got and how you've, you would do it. Very interesting. Maybe what I'll do is for next week, when you start putting together, I'll show everybody on the stream. You can drop me a picture and then they can see what you've been printing. Right, now tighten the top one. Now a little crack, click and a pop and a squeak. The first print. Don't know yet. Knowing me, lots of the guys jump in and try and do a thumb print, really, but to me, calibration. So calibration, I want to calibrate as much as I can up front. Okay, got those done. Two more bolts to tighten, and then we're done, or four more bolts. I mustn't forget these ones that are in the stack. But for them, I need to move this. Shouldn't use the ratchet too much, because I know with the ratchet I can over tighten things. You know, typically everybody wants to print a bench. Maybe I'll do a, once I've done the minor calibrations and stuff and made sure that at least I've got a flat bed and I've got a a level bed and a bed that's sticking, and I've done E-step calibration just to make sure that my E-steps are right. And maybe I'll just print a little. The easiest to get away with and will make it look the best is to print a vase in vase mode, because it doesn't need too much pressure advanced testing, so it doesn't need all those other settings which take time to set up. And then I'll look good because I just did a vase. And then I'll go offline and I'll go do all my calibration settings. Maybe I'll do some videos on those later. And then when I get back, then I'll do a nice big print of something. I don't know. We'll still see. Okay. So according to me, I've tightened everything. It looks all tight. It moves. It's smooth. And we can come back to this document. Did we do everything, Raymond? Looks like we did that. Movement, travel, small changes is normal, but okay. Right. Now we're gonna thread the belts through the system. And the belts go a specific way. Now what they're basically just trying to help you out with is trying to get that through, because it's very, very difficult to get the belt sometimes to go through the corners, because it doesn't slide through. Although I must say, these corners are rounded, so it should actually go through relatively easily. I'll give it one go, and if it doesn't come right, then I'll use the method with the zip tie as an extra trick that they've given us. But now, first thing I need to do is put the belts through. Now I can try and go through this picture and show you it's going to go the bottom belt is going to go all the way to the front. Which way is this printer? This is they're showing the left hand side of here. It's going to go all the way to the this is the left side, which is at the top. Yeah, the top belt's going to go all the way through, and then the bottom belt is going to come around a pulley at the back. So I'm going to try and figure a way to sort of show you how I'm doing the belts. I'll maybe put the camera at the top, and then we'll see how that goes. So give me a second while I sort of realign my camera and find the angle that might work. Let's see if I push these in a bit. I don't know if I'm going to find a way to actually get an angle here. Oh, very precarious, but we're gonna do it. Very precarious. Let's do it. Let's do that. Let's see. Can we see with that camera like that? Sorry, I'm trying to find the best way to get this camera to position itself. There we go. Okay. With that there, let's see. How does... Let's try that one. Okay. We need to see the length of this up to the front here. So if we just turn this slightly, you will be able to see most of what I'm doing. Right, let's try that. Okay, so top and bottom belt here. I put way too much belt on this side, so I'm just going to pull it back slightly. We'll get it even a little bit later. With looking through there, we're going to take this belt, the bottom belt. The bottom belt has got to go on the left hand side. It's got to go around the side here and down the bottom here. Okay, it doesn't come through to this side because the top belt comes through to this side on the left. Okay, so let's see how we do this. Let's see if I take an Allen key. Can I get an Allen key through today? Yes. Okay. Don't know if this is going to work that well, but let's see. That's not going to work. Very difficult to do it that way around. Again, the sheer size of this machine makes it quite challenging. Maybe just with a smaller Allen key, maybe that would work a little bit better. Make sure I've twisted the belt, because nothing worse than getting it through. Not going to be easy. Let's see, we've got some nice size. Okay, let's try method number two, which is push that through there and take an Allen key and maybe just hook it this way. Okay, as they said, would be easier, do it like that. Yeah, all the belt rollers are running perfectly. It's because of the shims and stuff, you can't over tighten them pretty much. You know,
the bolt push against the shims, and that doesn't touch the rollers at all. So I don't think there's any risk in that unless you really go crazy and over tighten it. Calibration model for RatRig, I think they use pretty much the generic whatever comes with the slices and whatever you have. There is a RatRig cube as far as I remember, something like that, but I'll have to go and look further. I haven't really looked much further into the actual calibration because I just use my own calibration methods. I just prefer to do it my way, but I'll definitely have a look and let everybody know as I go along. Let's just go back to this camera. Okay, so I've now pushed this cable tie through, yeah, as they've rightly recommended, sir. And I'm now going to push the belt and the cable tie, and well, Rob's your uncle. That's very nicely done, guys. That is.
I think my microphone's gone. I'll sort it out.
There you can hear my mic again. I think when I was bending over the machine, maybe I pushed against the button and the mic disappeared. I switched it off. Hopefully my microphone's working now again.
Had a battery go flat on me. Don't understand why. Pretty well charged.
So if you can see the mic lying on the table, and you can tell me see it on the table, and you can still hear me, then I'm good. I'm just going to leave it over there. I'll try and work around the mic. How about that? Okay, cool. Good evening to my lovely wife. Welcome. All the way from 7,000 kilometers away. Yes, we are making progress, and yes, we are learning new bugs. So, catch up on some of the comments that you guys have been throwing. Didn't realize my mic had gone off, and I don't know why it's going off, because it was charged fully, and normally it's got a 4 or 5 hour charge, so that should be fine. But next time I will charge it even more. Yes, and the cat is here. He is, you can't see him 100%, but he's sitting over here. He is enjoying himself. He's now part of the official stream. Okay, all right. Let's continue. Let's switch over to
And as you can see, we rooted the belts, and they were talking about the belts going front and back, and I pretty much explained all of that. And part two of the belts, we've done, rooted all those belts on the other side, through the bottom and through the sides, and that was the belts complete. Right. Now we're going to go to the bed arm assemblies. So, bed arm assembly, I think what we're going to do is first move some things around here and not try and get too much mic noise. Actually, I'm going to clip the mic on for a second.
Even then,
on it should be. It will work. I'm just remember when I stand up that the mic is clipped on. I'll try and do that. Okay. Some these things out of the way. And now I'm going to stand up. Let's see if I can grab. Let's grab this top camera. So now we're going to do a couple of things. First of all, that I want you to see. Nice and clearly. Okay. Can we see my hands?
Yes.
Cool. And we're going to bring this box of goodies closer. And we are now going to build these bed arm assemblies. Now, I've already built one just to make sure that it all sort of works. So we will go through the bed arm assemblies. You've got a left and a right assembly, right? And then we've got a back arm assembly. And we've got a whole bunch of stuff. Yeah, leave my belts. And I guess the more attention I give him, the more he does it. So yeah, I'll just leave him. See how far it goes. Okay. First of all, push pins in the front of these holes. Just slide through. These pins, now they say are very tight to push in. I must say to you, I didn't find them that difficult to push in, but maybe on the part that I used printed, no, I don't see them too difficult to print pushing through, although they are pretty tight. Let me just reach over here and grab this. I've got a piece of rail. It's got nice flat surfaces. Love using it. For every little thing that I need to push in, so it just makes it easier to push the rail in. Okay, and I feel they can go a little bit deeper. I'm gonna take a big star screwdriver and I'm gonna hold it very precariously and try and push that in just that last bit. Let's see if they will go in the last bit. There we go. Alright. So you can see I pushed them in all the way. Let's do the same with this piece. I know they're going to now explain front and back and back and front. Right. And yeah. Okay, these ones are super loose. Not very happy with that because that's just gonna fall out. So what I'm going to do is in the back holes over there, I'm just going to drop a dab of super glue, which I'm going to go fetch out of the cupboard. Luckily, I cleaned this whole place out, and I know where everything is. Good feeling. Now I'm just going to put a dab of super glue in the back of each hole here. Okay. That should hold that in pretty tight. once it's dry. Funny how the different holes print, but it's probably got to do very much with the print orientation or some of the print settings, the way it is, but that's fine. It's in. A bit of super glue will do more than enough work back then. Right, then now they just keep going to both. Then we are going to put in these nuts again in the bottom. These M5 nuts. Again, here I recommend actually using, oh, it's not M3, that's M5, it's M3s, M3 nuts. Let's just have a look if we can find the M3 nuts. Closer, you can yummy. And I'm going to take a long M3, a longer M3 bolt. Have I got a longer M3 bolt lying here somewhere? No, I don't. Let me see if they push in easily enough. That one went in easily enough. Maybe. That's the M3 screw. Just pull up there and then just pull it down all the way. That's fine. See if we can push it in without that. There we go. Now push it lightly with a screwdriver. Okay. That one. I get a feeling these ones are going to be harder to push in. Give me a second and see if I can get a M3 long bolt. If I leave the mic on the table, can you hear me okay with that? So I'm just using an M3. Okay, thanks, Grant. I'm just using M3 to pull these screws, because I've got a longer M3, yeah, just helps, you just need to catch the nut slightly, and then pull it through. Side. So they talk about that M3. nuts on that one, and 3 nuts on that one, then both have done. Then we're going to put in the left and right arm magnets and tighten them down, okay? These are these extremely powerful magnets that stick to every single little thing in your kit. Eventually put them on the rack as far away from as possible from everything. And we're going to tighten them with M312 countersunk screws. So again, this printer works on a different principle. It uses only 3 arms to level the bed out. So it uses a tri motor setup, which then will lift to the corners and the back, of the bed. And in theory, that's supposed to give you a level bed. Whereas something like the Voron printer, they use 4 motors, but they have a gantry that moves up and down, not the bed. So the gantry is that way the CoreXY, the print head is on, right? So that whole top piece is the gantry, and that moves up and down. They have it going right around. So it's actually the Voron has 1 extra motor in just for that purpose. Right, wrong, not gonna say. I think they both work. I didn't go with the Voron because the Voron lifts the gantry up and down, and I want to have the bed go up and down because I want to put in multiple print heads at a later stage, and I don't want the heads to have to go up and down to come fetch the whole time. Fetch the new head, which will be positioned at the top of the printer. So, just a personal first. And again, I like the fact that RatRig themselves actually put the kits together, because for me to source stuff from China and source from everywhere is difficult. Don't know always what quality I'm going to get, and I know there are lots of manufacturers out there at the moment that are putting kits together, Voron kits, and lots of the write-ups are very good. It's just my personal preference not to go that route. Would I like to build a Voron? Oh, for sure. Maybe the next printer will be a Voron. Right. Maybe I'll build a Voron 2.4 just because. So as soon as my printing services are up and I start running more and more prints, maybe I'll have the scope to actually do a Voron printer as well. Probably going to have to do a resin printer before that, just so that I can print stuff for Terry. Yeah, rare earth, mag something, what is it? Neodym. I can't even say the word properly. There it is. Pronounce it yourselves. Rare earth magnets. These magnets are super strong. In actual fact, these square ones aren't as strong as the round ones. The round ones are like painful to work with. Okay, so we've now tightened those magnets in there, both sides, with the nuts at the bottom. All right, I haven't missed anything. Now we're going to tighten the palm lead screw nuts, and the RatRig bi-metal lead screw decoupler. Very interesting coupler. It's actually got a different name in the market. I can't remember exactly what the other name was now, but you can actually Google them. Essentially what's happened, this is to show you, yeah, you've got your hole through the middle, right, where your rod's going to go through. Now, if your rod has a slight bit of wobble, right, slightly bent, then this whole thing has to move like that with the rod, okay? Which causes extra pressure and forces on the printer while it's doing that. And that causes artifacts in your different layers on the printer, because then it's fighting against the motor, then it's not fighting against the motor, then it's fighting against the motor. So that'll cause different lines. What this thing does, essentially, it says, okay, you can move, you tighten me there, and you tighten me there at the other end, and you can move anywhere you like, in any direction you like, within the tolerance of that hole, right? And I will keep the pressure off. So if I do that, you can sort of see where I'm trying to get at, which really makes a big difference. Now, I've never used these before. I'm excited to try them. And we'll see how that's going to perform, because I've had a lot of other ways. I've got the backlash nuts. I've got spider couplers on my other printers just to avoid all of that stuff. So it'd be good to see another way, something else that works as well. I need to find a set of M3x8. That could be one of them, because I need to remove that. Oh. Wish I could remember what that coupler was called. Got a funny name. Uncle Jam. Uncle Sam coupler or something like that. I can't remember. M3x8. There's the long ones I was looking for. Long M3s. Any guess? I need M3. Eight. Am I just missing it? Then have a look at the other pack. Hey, I would have expected M3s by 8s. I obviously misplaced them, because right in front of me, can you believe it? Right in front of me. M3 by 10s, by 12s, no. M3 by 8s. Yeah, after him, it's me again. And we're gonna need so what we're gonna do in the next picture is we're going to connect that to the coupler. So that bolted on there. Pretty simple. There's only two holes on either side of this bimetal screw decoupler. Okay. And I just hold it. That edge is nicely centered around the
around the palm screw. Funny names, palm screws, wire metal lead screw decoupler. But what does it do? It decouples it from the lead screw, meaning it doesn't actually follow the lead screw. Okay. Do that. Do both. I have not interchanged these to see what actually happens if I have to interchange them, so I'm not going to test it now. Don't feel like it. You're welcome to try it yourself. I almost think it might, I'm scared to think that it might be something like the rails, and you then have to find the matching twin. I'm not willing to test that. I'll see if I'm getting any more important WhatsApps. I don't know how much you actually missed, but at least you could see still when my mic went off. Pretty much the same for both sides. So if you really battle, you can call out to me and I'll do a separate video on that again if I have to. Okay, we're 20 minutes left. Sheesh, time flies. Let's see how far we can get with this. So we're now going to tighten these into the arms. Nothing to it, just put them in, align the holes. Tighten the screws. Right. Quickly put this one in as well. Oh, come on. While I'm turning the screw in, I'm thinking to myself, where did you put that Allen key? Can't see it anywhere. Meantime, it's under the sofa. See, cell phone's just distracting. But I've got it on. In case someone needs to phone me and tell me, hey, you need to fix something, like with the sound. Okay, you can see, I'm going to show you inside there. That thing can move around like that. As I said, it's got a bit of play. If your arm has got a bit of wobble or needs a little bit of movement, horizontal movement, it can. Okay, we've tightened those. We haven't over tightened them. In the next portion, we're going to now start. Okay, so we've done the back. The only difference on the back is once you put those little arms in, and you put the bottom nuts in, right? You put in the top ones, right? Then these ones have an additional step where we just need to go to the sides here.
and put the washers inside. Washers, listen to me. The line on that. Inside there. And then we're going to take, what was the clean screw? It was a M335. Yeah. I'll make sure I've got that there. Yes. Those are the M335 cap head screws, which are lying here as well. I must say the little plastic packets are getting less and less and less. Right, and we need one piece which I don't see at this point in time, and that is that the cable relief into part. See it lying around here? Let's see. That's going to go inside there. Okay, I'm going to put that through. Now this is for some other reason very, very tight. So just a little bit of help. Another one. Let's see if it's better. No, it's about the same. Well, I'll use this one.
I've printed one or two extra. I thought I'd use them in other places as well. Yeah.
Put the drawer right next to the microphone. Probably not the best thing, eh? Side adequately. I'm now going to attach that here, point that up. Right. And then I can just tighten the hand again. Okay, so that's also in place now, and that's just to help with the cables later, which I'm going to do modifications as well, so we'll have to see how it goes. Right, so now we need M312 screws, right, not those, these are M320s. Now let's find the M312s. No. Is it the M312? No, it is the M3. M312s. Don't see them again. Oh, there we are. Box of those. Okay. And these ones are going to drop down through here. And unfortunately, my little electric screwdriver is not going to fit down there, so I'm going to have to use Allen keys to get this in. You know what? That's very important. On this one, you can't put the decoupler in yet. And I've jumped the gun on that. You can't put the decoupler in yet because the screws have to go past the decoupler first. So I'm just going to have to remove the decoupler first quickly. Drop the gun there slightly. Just take the decoupler out. So that I can get the screws to go past. Oh, now they fall out. Let's get them positioned. You can see inside there. The Allen key's gone all the way through. Right. We actually have to get these things in there. A little bit tough. Not gonna be the easiest thing now to vibe all these screws through. Sorry, I'm having to look on my side so that I can get it straight. Okay. I'd like to try and finish this off tonight, put these on at least, maybe even the rails. I doubt it. We're gonna run out of time. 10 minutes left. No, I can go on longer if I want to. There's nothing, there's no technical reason why I can't go on longer, but just to be consistent in the terms of the timing that we use, I'm going to try and keep 3 hours videos. Right, so on the back here, on this block, we're going to put this note, this one, so. With the screws aligned, this one's in the trenches here. Can't probably hear me that well from here, so let's put a little bit louder. There you go. I've got one in. Okay, doesn't seem to be going in that easy. I'm just going to grab my
plug it up here, and hopefully. You can still hear me. Alright. And then. Let's see if we can get this one through. Okay, seems like I'm having a little bit of a challenge to get the second hole screw to actually align. looking on the side, yeah. And then actually see the screw coming through. Okay.
Try again, let's take it off. Seems like we're not successful there. Wish I had a bit of a longer Allen key for this. Let me just check something. Yep. That's definitely the right one. Right, so why are you not working?
Let me just have a quick look here, see if I can see why. Why that screw won't go through. Definitely M3x12s, but they're not really happy to go through here. Well, that's definitely not an M3x12. So that's probably why I'm battling. What would be the odds that I grabbed two different lengths? Can you believe it? All right, that's better. I would have been trying to get those M3x8s through for quite some time. Would never have got there. Okay. Showed up to the party short. Don't know how I got those. That's better.
Okay. That one caught. That one port on. Let's see. I think we're getting there. Yeah. Yes. 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 Okay, gang. Be careful not to over tighten this. You are tightening it into the block. You strip the block. It's gone. Yeah. Right, that's that one done. And we can come across to this side. Right. And we're going to do this one. Now, on this one, what I can quickly show on that one is just we're going to put the decoupler back in. Oh, that's how I got these two screws. Silly me. I used the decoupler screws that were lying on the table in front of me. What's the time? Can't see the time from here. And I'm not wearing my watch, and the reason why I'm not wearing my watch is because it keeps banging and scratching against the metal, the gantry, the extrusion, the metal extrusions. So I'm tired of damaging my own printer. So the decoupler's in. And I've got like 4 minutes. Maybe I can get it done. Let's see. And they're gonna put that rod in first, but I'm first gonna put this one in, attach this, and we can do the rods next week because I wanna show you something specifically on the rods. So M320s on this one as well. Should be 4 of them, yes. This is the one packet that I found that was wrong yesterday. And I had to quickly find another M420. Luckily, I've got lots of spares lying around. I actually haven't even checked. Maybe they gave you a spare in the spare packet. There's 2 packets over there that says RatRig spares. Maybe it's in there. Maybe I should just have a look. Because I assume they know that you will lose 1 or 2 things. Okay. Right. Tightened. It's good. Good. And that's it. So this is what our bed's going to be lying on, and I'll show you that it's likely in the next stream. But I think that's all we got time for. We only got like 2 minutes left, and the next step would be rods, and I really want to show you something about the rods before I rush that piece. So thank you very much for everybody for who joined, and hope it helps for those that are watching in the future as to how a RatRig V-Core3.1 500 gets put together. Remember to like the videos and subscribe, and throw me some comments. Tell me what you think. What can I change? What can I do? Appreciate all the help and all the support. Have a good evening. Thanks, H. Cheers.